Praise the Lord. Welcome to Heart, another week, but we're all still standing and we're still strong. And we want to just shout out to our church and praying for you, and we miss you, and we're getting closer to coming back and to see the church, you know, everybody here in church worshiping the Lord. We miss them.
Oh, gosh, do we miss you ever? You know, it's so exciting that we're going to be able to just come back together and see each other and just know that great things are coming up ahead. And, you know, I know it's been a kind of a long season, right? It just feels long. But the anticipation that we're expecting as we come together as the body of Christ, I know that I can't wait. I truly can't wait.
Yeah, it's been long. It's not easy to preach to just empty pews, and this is a lot of work.
It is.
With our media team and the entire team working hard, you know, 3-4 times a week, and just making sure that we're connected. And then we've been having this weekend is the weekend of Wi-Fi problems. Friday night, right at 1:30, the Wi-Fi went out, and we just kept praying. And tell you what, the power of God fell in this place. It really fell in this place. And then this morning we had a glitch, an interruption in our service for about 10 minutes, but we came back, and it's amazing that everybody came back and listened to it. So
Amen.
It's a lot of commitment here, but we're getting close. And I do want to say this, that we are targeting a Father's Day to open up for the whole church. And what we're going to be doing next week and the week after is that we are going to be having some soft openings with some of our leadership here to make sure that we have all of our procedures in place so that when our people do come back on Father's Day, you're going to hear more about it. I'm going to be speaking at the church, but for these next 2 weeks, but we are targeting Father's Day to come back, open the church, and probably have double services. But at the same time, we're still going to be streaming.
That's exciting.
We're still going to be streaming for those who
are not able to join us.
They might not be able to join us and not ready for it. But I'm going to tell you, just don't let fear. You know, we cannot let fear run our lives. We cannot let fear. And there's a lot of people. I hear, man, some of these big churches even sending out surveys and getting back that 5 to 10% of the people might not even ever come back. If that happens, then the enemy wins, man. He wins. We're going to connect. We're going to be safe. We're gonna have all of our safeguards in place to be able to keep our people safe. Because, you know, we're living in a changing world. And what's happening in our city today, the last 3 or 4 days, what's happening downtown is very heart-wrenching. It's very sobering, you know. And I don't think it's just the issue of racism. I think also that it is that people have a lot of pent-up anger inside of their lives, and they're just letting it out that way. But we do want to pray for our city.
Right. And, you know, I think the enemy is just really trying to come in and just stir the pot, because he's not been able to waver us. In this season, we've continued to press in. We've continued to seek the Lord more than we ever have before. And so I just feel like the enemy wants to come in and just throw another wrench in there to distract us and to keep us from moving forward and continue to bring another kind of fear. But you know what? What the enemy has intended for evil, you know, I believe God's going to turn it around for something good, because I believe that God has something for the body of Christ and for the church. I know that he's taken us all to another level. And you know, God's protection is over us. You know, yesterday I was talking with Jill, who works in the nursing homes. And she said, you know what, I have no fear. And she said, you know, when I was out in the world, I believe that, because she went through our women's home. She's a graduate of our home. And she really touched me yesterday, because she said something so powerful. She said, when I was out there in the world, I believe that God had his hand upon my life, and he protected me then. And she said, then I went through the home, and I went through all these different steps, and God has been with me. So she said, why wouldn't God protect me now? So it's like, that is so beautiful to know that God has a plan for our lives, and he's going to protect us in every season, no matter what.
And I think that we just need to just trust in God.
Yes.
Don't let this second wave of fear, you know, grip our hearts and grip our emotions. And God is in control. Amen. God is in control.
Right.
And it's a new season that God is going to put a new anointing over our ministry, put a new anointing over our church to reach this city like we've never reached before. You have a lot of women's things coming up this week that are exciting. So why don't you just...
This week is a power-packed week. It's going to be starting tomorrow night with our multi-region. Yes. And that's going to be exciting. I love...
Five regions strong.
Right. To be able to come together and just have a time of not only fellowship, but just hearing from the Lord. And I know that if God has done something in our lives, God is doing that with all the women all over all the regions. So from our multi-region... Each of the pastor's wives are going to be sharing a brief message, but we're going to get to hear from them and see them. But then just gathering together from all over. Isn't that beautiful?
Yes.
All the Texas regions, Rio Grande region, the Rocky Mountain region. So we're going to be here, and it's going to start at 6:30 Mountain Time. And so I know that's right. That's Mountain Time.
Right.
And that's the same time for New Mexico, but also in Texas, it's an hour later. So it's going to be 7:30 for their time. We're going to have special music. And so, so it's exciting. And then also, we have Code Red all week long. And it's, you know, a powerful ministry that we're going to be targeting the treasures, the Twilight treasures. And we're going to be talking about more about that later on in the show. And then also, Saturday, we're going to end with a power pack service with none other than our founder, Sister Julie, right at 9 a.m. Pacific time. And she's going to be ministering to us from all over the world. Isn't that exciting?
Exciting. Well, the men are doing nothing. Huh? What's going on here? It's all women this week. Amen. Praise the Lord. But the men can be involved in Code Red also. We'll be talking about that. But I want you to know something. It's a new season, Victory Arch Denver. It is a new season. We're coming out of this.
Right.
And we're going into this a new season. And the worship team this morning sang a beautiful song. It's one of my favorite songs. It's called New Season. And so we want you to... Listen, we want you to proclaim and declare it. This is a new season for your life and for our church. Listen to it.
It's a new season. It's a new is flowing my way. It's a season of power and prosperity. It's a new season coming to me. It's a new season. It's a new day of fresh anointing. Coming out.
greater. And it's a new season, and I believe with all my heart, and I believe that God is going to pour out something brand new, something he's never poured out before in the history of our world. And I believe this next revival, third wave revival, this next harvest is going to be powerful. This afternoon, we have something very special. We have some very special guests. We have Pastor Marcos and Sister Erica with us. Amen. And it's a blessing to have both a very, very special, special couple. You know, that God, there are treasures out of darkness, both of them. And God, so faithful to our ministry. Both of them are someone that we love very, very, very much. And I know that Erica works with you, even with the kids gang. Everybody works with you, the kids gang. Amen.
I know. I can't help but recruit everybody that... And she's so gifted in so many different ways, and she doesn't even realize how gifted she is. But she helps me in so many different ways.
Today I want you to, what I would want to do, and I want them to share a little bit about the testimony because they're both treasures. But I want, the theme of our show today is really, you know, the things that they overcame in their life after they were saved. Some people think that you know, you get saved and everything is just going to go, man, there. This is a world that we live in that has a lot of pain. Yeah. And they are both really overcomers. Mm-hmm. That they were knocked down for a bit, but they got back up again. And I think this is such an important message to get to people. Yeah. Because a lot of people give up in their Christianity. They give up when they're hit. But maybe, Marcos, you could share a little bit about your testimony. It's a product of the recovery home. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
Thank you, Pastor Tom, Sister Dorothy, for having me. I just want to give all the honor and glory to God. You know, I came, you know, from a lifestyle of drug addiction and using meth. And, you know, one of my lowest points is when I started shooting up. And that's where I desperately needed intervention. And somebody told me about Victory Outreach, the men's home, and there in Las Vegas. And, man, it's been a journey. I've been saved now for 20 years now.
20 years.
Yeah, 20 years. And you know, for some reason, Pastor, you know, I don't know, when I first went to my world conference in Long Beach, I can't remember all the messages, but something about your message that stood out. And I found myself a connection with you at that. It was something that... Like God was saying, this is the man that you're going
it
to.
It seems like God orchestrated me into your life, even finding you in Estes Park, and yes. That's another show, and
yes. Then
where we met, and he asked if you could go to the men's retreat, and I'd met you in Vegas anyway.
Yeah, first that connection in World Conference, then in Vegas, you know, and then I came to Denver, and I ended up... in Estes Park, and we met. Then I came in Estes Park. So then when I came to Denver, I met you. It was Father's Day, and I met you with some of your church members at a restaurant.
Oh, wow.
And then we're like, you know, this is God. And I've been with Pastor Tom over a little bit over 18 years now. Oh, wow. Amen. So
God's a faithful God.
Amen. Amen.
And Erica, you know, Erica came from that lifestyle too.
Yes.
Share a little bit about that.
I did. I also was, I was lost. I was a drug addict. I remember my lowest point was remembering coming out of it and not knowing where my kids were. I remember at that time coming out of it, and I remember started running down the streets looking for my kids because I didn't remember where I left them. And that was my lowest point. That's when I remember thinking, this, I can't continue living this life.
God saved your life.
Yes, he did.
Transformed your life.
Yes, he did.
Both of you. And you both have been active in ministry, very faithful, both of them, very faithful.
Yeah, you've seen them in every aspect of the church. You know, you've seen them serving in all different capacities. And to think that you were both such drug addicts, is, you know, to me, Erica, you know, it's like, and to see how the Lord truly transformed.
You were a bartender too? 10 bars?
Yes. Come on. Yes, I was. I was a bartender.
Well, I didn't remember that one.
Yeah, I remember that. For some reason, I remember that about her, that she was a bartender. Yeah. It came out of one of the stories, yeah.
Oh, wow.
When I first came into the ministry, I had this great idea of opening the cafe because that's the lifestyle I came from. And I remember thinking, wow, look what God has done, you know.
And we've seen God raise both of you up, especially Marcos. Marcos became a licensed minister, and then we launched Marcos out. He began, he pastored a baby church in Commerce City, and God was really using your life. And I think that it's real important that we share a story like this, because you both had some real crisis in both your lives. And like, just share a little bit of that embarrassing or just, you know, but I think it's a story that people need to hear, and that both had their marriages, both your marriages, the enemy came in and destroyed your marriages, and, you know, and it was hard, especially it was hard for Pastor Marcos, because he had to rebound from being a pastor already, and, but thank God you're still here, tell me a little bit about getting back up, because, you know, we as believers, we have so many dreams, we have so many plans, and we never insert any kind of failure in there. Failure is a part of life, man. Right. Failure is a part of life, and I've seen so many believers, you know, have a failure in their marriages, and never rebound from it. But you two have rebounded. Tell me a little bit about getting back up.
Yes, Pastor. You launched us out, and it was very difficult and embarrassing to even speak about it, but you know, of course, you know, there's many that think that nothing can happen now that you're saved or a Christian, or even as a minister, a pastor. It was very difficult to accept it, but you know, there was unfaithfulness in my marriage, and as a pastor, it's like it's heartbreaking. But you know, yes, I'm still here by the grace of God. And I remember when that happened, the first person I called was you. And I said, I can't do this. But you gave me words of encouragement, words of wisdom. You can do this. Yeah. You know, it's not in your own strength, but with God, you're going to come through
this. I think it's important because you had little small kids.
And
too.
I had my little ones. Yeah. It's hard to explain. But, God really turned things around in my life. The aspects of ministry, I really shied away for a while. I allowed a season for God to
restore
me and heal me. And even with the men's home, it kind of, because I've been part of the men's home forever. It's my life, you know. But even I shied away from being part of the men's home. Mm-hmm. And thank Rafa and Jasmine have always kind of, hey, Pastor, can you come and kind of have a connection with the home again? And God just, you know, it's been.
And I remember one time you preached a message that was like, and the reason why I remember that message is because my daughter Stephanie said, I'd never heard a message like that. I mean, I was gone. I was traveling somewhere, and you spoke of a message about the potter and the clay.
Yes.
And
I remember that message.
And my daughter.
Yes.
My kids, you know, they don't make a lot of compliments, but man, God really spoke to her life. Do you remember that?
Right. Yes. Because Pastor Marcos, you know, sometimes people's lives do fall apart. Mm-hmm. But it's so beautiful, that message that the Lord gave you on how he put it all back together.
Yes.
And I saw you, you know, sitting in the front year after year, month after month, and just seeing how God was just repairing and restoring your heart, your mind, every part of your life. Yeah. And I thank God for his keeping power over your lives.
Yes.
Truly. His keeping power.
And Erica, too. Erica, share a little bit about, you know, your ordeal, your marriage, yeah?
Yes. I also, I came into the church married with my two daughters, and he just struggled with drug addiction, and he just wouldn't let it go. And I remember feeling so fearful that somebody had mentioned to me when he left the church, somebody had told me the statistic is that when a spouse leaves, soon after the other one leaves.
Yeah.
And I remember that time going home and really scared that if I ever go back, what would happen to my kids?
Yeah.
And I remember that because of that, I remember just pleading to God, like, for your keeping power. Right. And that's truly what has happened.
And
it's,
I think, keeping power. Sometimes you stop living for yourself, but you keep living for your kids. And I think I saw that in both of you. You kept living, you know, motionless, you know, broken. And then love was in the air, and he brought you two together. Amen. I brought you two together, and I saw it right away. I felt good about it right away. I mean, there's a process, but I felt like, you know, that God was in this, and so did you.
Yeah. And it's beautiful to see how God restores, and then he brings life back. And, you know, it's like when you think it's never, ever going to happen, you know, but God just kind of, that's the God that we serve. You know, he gives us a future, right?
Yes.
Right. Yes. How did you feel about that, Marcos?
We asked God for confirmation. Mm-hmm. She's the Gideon. She always asking for
confirmation.
What was
the gift confirmation?
So I was like Gideon because I kept asking. I know my youngest daughter, I know that she was going to have the hardest time.
Right.
So I said, if this is of you, God, she will bring it to me. She will be the one to, you know, be okay with it. And I remember he will pursue, and I was like, no, get away from me. Don't call me. And I remember my daughter one time, she, on her own, we were driving, and she's the one that said, hey, Mom, you should give him an opportunity. And I was like, oh, no. And then I'm like, God, that's not God. God, if this is you, Sister Dodie herself will talk to me about it. And then when she did, I'm like, oh, no, that's not God. I remember all the way till we were getting married, I was standing behind the curtains and still asking God then in the dress. And I remember walking down the aisle so nervous and, you know, shaking. And but I remember the time that he held his hand for me to take a step. I remember the peace that I felt, that I was telling him, like, I had my body stopped shaking automatically. And I knew then. But I knew then when I grabbed his hand.
That was the day of the wedding.
That was the day of the wedding. Even behind the curtains, I was like, God, if this is not you, you know, I can still back down. I can still turn around.
But look what God has done. And I just want to say this, that we're very proud of you guys. You know, very proud of you. That's not an easy road. Especially when you have kids, two families, blended families are not easy. I know it has been easy. But I do want to say this. I know that God's got a second season for you.
Amen.
Marcos, he's got a second season for you. He processes us to prepare us for something. And it's that second season that's coming up. And we want to tell you guys that we love you very, very much. And we look to you guys for strength. When I have as long as I can see my leaders, as long as I can see them, we're strong. And we want to thank you for joining us on this. And we want to tell you that we love you. And just remember that there's a second season coming in your lives.
Amen.
Life ain't over. Even with all that white hair, your life ain't over. Amen. Amen. You know, there's a song that Dodie and I love. We love it. And it is our testimony. And I don't get tired of hearing it. And it's a song called He's Been Faithful. It's a song that we've sang all our lives. And I believe this is way back when we were on Dover Street that my daughter and my son, Jordan and Crystal, sang this song, He's Been Faithful. I want to take you back there. And if there's anything this couple can say, you know, husbands might not be faithful. Wives might not be faithful. Even church friends might not be faithful.
But God.
God's faithful. God is a faithful, faithful God. Listen to this.
Doubt and fear, every pain and every tear, there's a God who's been faithful to me. When my strength was all gone, His promise is true.
That I love in that song the most, though in my heart I had questions,
right,
even failed to believe,
right, because we all that yeah. all happens to us at
but
some
he's
point
he's been faithful,
right, and he remains faithful.
Yes. Even when we don't believe and we have questions, God is a faithful God. Well, our second guest is someone that we love very, very much, and to me she has one of the most incredible stories. The very fact that she's still standing even as a young girl, and that's Sister Lexi, it's a blessing to have you.
Yes, and, so good to have you.
Yes, yeah, so she's part of our team here during this pandemic. She's the stage manager. Amen. She helps us. She yells at everybody, telling them to get in order. But Lexi, we love you, and it's a big blessing to be here. And I want you to share a little bit about your testimony. When you got saved, you were just a young girl. You were on your own, and yeah. From a young age, the age of 12 years old. Share a little bit about that.
I was basically on my own, and my brothers and sisters, there's 15 of us, so we all scattered, and we were living on survival mode, living on the in and out, just trying to figure out what we're going to do. And then one day, God interrupted my life and allowed my brother to take me in. Yeah, he took me in. He raised me since I was 12, and ever since then, I lived in a pastor's house.
But you were actually living on the streets, and then with raising one of your youngest brothers also.
For a moment, I had him for a few months when I didn't know where my mom was at. I also lived in a drug house for a while. I would sleep wherever I can. I would sleep at friends. I couldn't go to school. I was expelled. No school wanted me, and I was supposed to be in school in sixth grade, and I couldn't go to school, and I was living from couch to couch, from house to house, and it was just a very dramatic.
You know, but tell us about that moment when you ended up going to your brother's house. Pastor Rich,
yes, Pastor
for those
Rich.
Of you that don't know, that's her brother, and so, you know, how did you end up there?
Well, there was one point in my life when I was living at one of my other siblings' house. It was just very dark. It was very ugly. There was no structure. There was nothing. And I remember I didn't want this life. I remember that I didn't want to live like this. And I'm a 12-year-old girl, and I shouldn't be living like this. And I remember that I had a brother. And me and Richard, we didn't really know each other, but we knew each other. But I knew that Richard was someone that went to church and loved God, and he lived a different life, and I wanted that. And I remember I ran away. I remember I had enough, and I remember running far away from this lifestyle, and I ended up running into him, and he brought some groceries over, and we talked. I went to church, and it was one night. My brother picked me up, my other brother, and he took me to Buffalo Wild Wings, and the entire church was there. And I'm like, oh, gosh, this is so nerve-wracking. But I was high. I was so high. And I remember
And you were only 12
at
that time?
Yeah. I was, it was embarrassing now. Just kidding. But it's part of my life, you know.
Right.
And I'm grateful for what God did. And in that moment, like, at Buffalo Wild Wings, I became, like, I wasn't high anymore. It was like Jesus, like, sobered me up right there. And I remember God, like, it just felt like a movie. It just felt so unreal. And Richard came up to me, and he was like, do you have a place to crash? And I didn't. And I don't know why I said yes, I would go over to your house. And I remember that he made enough room. Like, all of his kids shared one room, all four of his kids. And he made enough room for me that night. And it ended up being years later.
Amen. What a beautiful story.
That's a heavy story. And you know, it's not an uncommon story.
Right.
I mean, in this day and age, there are kids out there living on their own, you know, and then the grace of God interrupted your life.
Mm-hmm.
He interrupted your life. And then, you know, God put your life together, and then God, you know, you were able to get married. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted Lexi on the program, was along with Marcos and Erica, is because then she had a crisis in her life also. And she became a single mom with two kids, raising two young kids. And, you know, there are a lot of single moms out there that, you know, that to several things, they can't make it, or they run to another man, the arms of another man, and make things even worse. But we've seen you stand your ground,
yes,
raising those boys. And, you know, share a little bit about that. You know, I know it's not easy to say that. Share a little bit, but man, there are people that need to hear this story, because there are so many lonely women that are left with children that don't have nobody to reach out to, and then feel like they're a failure in life.
You know, being a single mom, I always tell people that it's probably one of the hardest things that I've ever endured. Not because, like, I'm doing it on my own, but it's just like you're responsible for two lives, you know? Yes. Other, like, you're responsible for your kids. And I think that for me, that God has been so faithful in my life. Yes. He has kept me. I've had a huge support system. I have a church that, like, has my back and, like, that loves me. But I count my kids as a privilege. Amen. And I don't take that lightly. And I feel like being a mother is a calling. Right. And so for me, when I knew, when my marriage like failed and it like came into pieces, there was a scripture in Psalms 57, and God said, Psalms 57:1, it says, "I will hide you in the shadow of the wings until disaster passes by."
Wow.
And in that scripture, wow, I told God, like, "I will hide under your wings. I will stand and plant my feet until we could see, like, you know, a good view." But
yeah,
that's what's kept me, is God, you know.
Man.
And for any single mom out there, like, right, it is hard. It's a lot of work, but it's so worth it. Your kids are so worth it. They are your legacy. And I love investing into my boys. And I can't wait to see what men of God they will become.
Wow.
Amen. And then to see how God has provided for you. You have a great job and without the education.
Yeah.
And so tell us, I mean, how God has just truly made a way. You have your own place and how God has just truly kept you.
You know, I believe God allows certain things to happen in people's lives. And I'm very fortunate to, God has allowed a lot of things in my life to happen. And but he has also given me a lot of opportunities, and he's also blessed me. I work for an arborist company. I'm an administration assistant, and I work a lot in the billing, and I handle a lot of one side of a department. And God has really allowed me to just explore and to learn. And my boss is really, he's such a really good boss. Like, I believe that God really sent this company my way. He's understanding. He's flexible for me as a single mom, and he understands what I have to do. And but not only that, I do live on my own with my two boys. I pay all my bills. I'm a whole adult. Just kidding. But it's God's been really faithful.
Wow, what a blessing you are.
Yes.
You're a big, big blessing, and you're a testimony to this generation. You're only 25. Yeah, last year, last week, she turned 25. She says, "I'm
she's
old."
She's over the hill.
Yeah,
I'm
I know.
Old.
No, she's not. Lexi, I want you to say a prayer, okay? I want you to pray, because I know there's couples like Marcos and Erica, and there's people that have failed, even in the Christianity, that failure has come into their life, they think. But I want you to say a prayer, because especially this
yes.
generation,
yeah.
there is a lot of single moms out there. There are a lot of young women with children that cannot find their place. They cannot, because the moral of this story is, the foundation of this story is, none of this would ever happen without God.
Right.
It is her relationship with God and the community of the church and having a strong backing, you know, a good foundation that has kept her through all the hard times and built a foundation. And I want you to pray for any broken single mom out there that feels like they're failure because they don't have a man in their life, but God plays that role in your
yeah.
life right now. So I would like you to pray.
Heavenly Father, I come before you, Lord. And
yes, Lord.
God, we just thank you, God, for your keeping power over our lives, Lord. And I pray, God, that right now for any single mom, any single parent that is out there raising their kids on their own and that is working 9 to 5, working even a second job, God, I pray, Lord, that you would be there, God, that you would strengthen them, my God, that your word says that you are close to the brokenhearted, my God. And I pray, God, that you would be close and draw near, my Lord. And I pray, Lord, that you would hide them in the shadow of your wings, God, that, Lord, that in this season and in this dark time, sometimes that, God, it's so hard to see you, my God, but Lord, I pray right now that your love would begin to saturate their lives,
yes,
God,
Lord.
That you would protect their children, that you would guard their mind and their heart from the top of their heads to the soles of their feet, God. And I pray, God, that you would begin give us victory, God, that Lord, that we pray, Lord, that I pray for every single mom that feels like it's a lot, like she can't move, that she can't continue, that God, that Lord, that you would give her strength to make one more step, God, that her children will be a reminder and a reflection reflection of your mercy and your grace, yes, my God. And I pray over their lives, Lord. I pray over the mother. I pray over even the community that you surround them with, that you would begin, God, to surround them with a good village to help raise their children, God. That, Lord, it takes a village to raise kids, Lord. And I pray, God, that you would begin, God, to give them support, give them resources, God. And I pray, Lord, that you would be their life, Lord, that you would be in the center of it all, my God. And most of all, God, I just pray, Lord, that you would just be there, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. Well, Lexi, we'll just tell you that we love you.
Thank you. I love you guys.
We're proud of you. Very proud of you.
Thank you.
And praise the Lord. And you survived, Pastor Rich. Amen. Praise the Lord.
You survive anything.
The great discipleship.
We'll just keep that between
us. Yeah, great discipler. He's a great,
great
discipler. So listen, great. We want to thank you and for joining us. You know, once again, we do this because we want to stay connected to our people. We love our church, man. I miss you. I said this morning, yesterday, went to a barbecue, and the little boy, one of the little kids in the church, just kept,
Darius,
he couldn't get enough of me. He was just sitting right up to next to me, and I know that we all miss each other. And I do want to say this, is that in 2 days, it's Sister Dodie's birthday. Oh. Woo! She's turning 24. You're younger than you, Lexi. 24 years old. And I know God has blessed her with her, yes, children, grandchildren, and the ministry that we love so much. And so it's going to be a good celebration week. Amen. With all the other stuff that's taking place for all the women. Listen, we want you to stay connected, especially with your life group. Connect with the life group. And we want to tell you that, once again, I'm going to say this, that we're coming in for a landing here in this season. Father's Day is going to be our opening, that we're going to be opening the church. So you begin to pray that God really, really, as we prepare the church, the safeguards, that God would just, that you'd feel in your spirit to come back to church. We love you. We miss you. And we got your back heart to heart. Amen.
Yes.
Heart to heart. We love you. And we're going out with some video announcements, but we want to tell you that we love you. God bless you, Victory Outreach Denver. Be strong. Amen. For those of you who don't know, we live stream. You can download the app on YouTube. We have an app on YouTube, and you can actually tell your family to watch services. They don't want to come to church, then they can watch services on our streaming. It's live. We are streaming live all over the world right now.